Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our session today. This is part of the series on global opportunities in housing. So we at the Habitat for Humanities Terwilliger Center for Innovation in Shelter want to introduce shelter as a theme, low-income affordable housing that is also sustainable as a theme in the discussions on impact. And towards that, you know, we have been doing a few sessions. We had one yesterday. Today's session will be focused in on India-centric startups and innovations. And our topic is Homes for a Sustainable World. And we will focus on India's early success with climate resilient solutions. We will kick off the session with Anoop Nambiar, who is the country head for the Terwilliger Center for Innovation in Shelter. Anoop leads the efforts in developing market-based solutions for affordable housing in India. He has over two decades of experience across corporate and impact sector in technology management, innovation management, and venture support. Over to you, Anoop.
Thank you, Meera. Good afternoon, everyone. We are delighted to be here at Sangalp today. On behalf of the organizing committee of the 2020 Sangalp Global Summit, I welcome you to today's session on Homes for a Sustainable World, India's successes with climate resilient solutions. I am Anoop Nambiar, and I lead the country program at Habitat for Humanity's Terwilliger Center for Innovation and Shelter. The Terwilliger Center works to develop market-based solutions for improved and affordable shelter. Our work is mainly in three broad areas. We strengthen affordable housing value chains to make building materials and services available to low-income families to help them either build or improve their homes. We stimulate innovations in shelter and support startups and entrepreneurs who have a shelter-based innovation. And we also mobilize investments so that low-income families may have access to affordable financing for their housing needs. All of this is directed towards moving housing solutions to scale. Roughly a billion people worldwide now live in slum conditions, and 1.6 billion people live in inadequate or substandard housing. Housing has a long-term impact on health, well-being, education, and livelihoods of families. Every 16 minutes, a family somewhere in the world is benefiting from our work. Over the last 40 years, Habitat for Humanity International has cumulatively impacted 29 million people worldwide with improved shelter conditions. Through our participation and discussions at Sangalp, we want to bring attention to this very important need for basic shelter and to ensure everyone has a chance at a brighter future. So for today's session, we have an esteemed group of experts from various organizations focusing on climate change, urban infrastructure, green housing, as well as startups with innovative solutions for energy efficient and sustainable housing. Let me take you through the flow of events for the session today. The session is organized into three parts. In the first part, the first discussion is with Shruti Narayan from IFC's Asia Pacific Cities platform on the topic, why green housing makes business sense. In the second part of the discussion, we have Dr. Shailesh Agarwal, Executive Director of BMTPC, Building Materials and Technology Promotion Council from the Ministry of Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation. And he will talk about Government of India initiatives in creating an enabling environment for affordable housing in India. And finally, we will learn from some of the startups who are doing pioneering work in this space. We have with us Twasta, we have EcoSTP, Kaushal Bhav, Motroof, and Saltech, and they will be talking about their respective innovations in sustainable housing in a session to be moderated by Deepak Vishwanathan of the Terwilliger Center. Once again, I welcome all the speakers and their organizations to the session today. So let me introduce Shruti Narayan, who is our first speaker for the session today. Shruti Narayan from IFC's Asia Pacific Cities platform is an urban and climate change specialist with close to two decades of experience. Previously, she was a regional lead for the Green Building Program South Asia at IFC. Shruti is an architect, and she also has a master's degree in building and climate change. In addition to deep technical knowledge of green buildings and clean energy, she also has significant experience in addressing broader issues such as water management, urban mobility, waste management, food systems, water, and adaptation. Additionally, Shruti has significant experience in structuring financial instruments to mobilize capital for green housing and attract private sector participation to create market opportunities. Shruti, it's always a pleasure to have you with us, and welcome to the session today.
Thank you, Anup, and I echo your, thanks to Sankalp and, Habitat for Humanity for picking up such an, important and critical topic for discussion today. So I look forward to the flow of events. I think it's very well structured in bringing together different stakeholders to talk about a very important topic.
Thank you. Thank you, Shruti. Do you want to briefly speak about your work at IFC and then, we can get started? Do you want to give us a bit of background about what you do at IFC?
Sure. So thank you once again. So I am an upstream officer with IFC's Asia Pacific Cities platform. I was in my past role leading the green building program for South Asia. And, as you're aware, IFC is the private sector arm of the World Bank Group, primarily looks at creating markets through, leveraging financing. They finance private sector. Recently, in the last couple of years, IFC has structured these platforms across the world. There are three platforms. One is in Latin America, one is in Africa, and one is in Asia Pacific that look at cities. And why is it critical? It's because, a lot of points that Anup highlighted and the discussion that we're going to have is actually looking at, the entire dialogue of urbanization, which is triggering like the housing shortage, right? I mean, that's kind of the reason why we're having a housing shortage. And one of the things that the cities platform does is it actually sort of mobilizes, the leaders, political leaders and leaders across the government to look and review what could be the opportunities at different levels of the urban centers like the cities, the states, and the nation to see what could be opportunities across board in improving the urban infrastructure, and which includes affordable housing, healthcare, transportation, water, and we're going to talk about how all of that is sort of interconnected, right? I mean, ultimately to create a good environment. And IFC does that by leveraging financing and also providing technical assistance to, the city leaders, and also by, creating instruments and mechanisms where private sector participation can be enhanced, right? Because that ensures the longevity and sustainability of any solutions when you're able to create markets.
Yeah, thanks, Shruti. I think, the cities platform has been playing a very pivotal role in bringing, the various stakeholders together, and especially working with the government on one side, the private sector on the other side. Thank you for that introduction. If you see a few events over the last week, has put climate change back in the spotlight, right? So last week, the Rockefeller Foundation announced that they will commit USD $1 billion over the next 3 years to catalyze a more inclusive green recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. And tomorrow, on November 4th, US is all set to officially withdraw from the Paris Climate Agreement, right? And locally in the Asia Pacific and especially in India, cities are at the center of economic growth and development. And as the population grows, and people are moving to cities due to rapid urbanization, which is expected that more than 400 million homes will need to be built worldwide by 2025, and most of them, going to be built in developing countries, right? And Asia Pacific hosts over 20 of the world's mega cities, right? And 60% of the region's urbanites live in urban areas with populations of less than 1 million. So the human dimensions of urbanization and climate change, especially its impact on the daily challenges of the urban poor in terms of employment, livelihoods, safety, health, housing, and access to basic services are critical. So today, the session's theme focuses on exploring how we can build homes for a sustainable world, for the communities, for the planet, and for the economies at large, right? So we're going to structure the conversation around four main topics, or four main themes around green housing and affordable housing. So first, we have how do we make green housing affordable? I think so that's going to be the first topic of discussion. The second one, we will talk about investment opportunities in green housing, and then finally we will move towards beyond finance, you know, what is the role of the ecosystem in bringing it all together? And finally, we will look at how do we measure the progress on a green housing program, right? So that's how roughly the sessions are structured. So if you see the definition by the Indian Green Building Council, IGBC, a green building is one which uses less water, optimizes energy efficiency, conserves natural resources, generates less waste, and provides healthier spaces, living spaces for occupants as compared to a conventional building. So how do you see the landscape for green cities and green housing in India and the Asia Pacific? Tell us about IFC's approach in this space.
Thank you, Anup, for setting that context. You know, so just to kind of reiterate what you said, like Asia Pacific is very critical, right? Because, you know, just to summarize what you said, and, you know, like it's about 1/4 of the world's population and about half of the world's poor, right? So in a nutshell, if you look at that, and, you know, and when you start talking about population, of course, they need to be housed somewhere, right? So you start then looking at why there is a shortage of housing, and the quality of housing is also important, right? Now, there are three sort of, you know, levels, I say. So first is the identification of the problem. The second is the awareness generation. And the third is probably the implementation, right? And I'm kind of just going to set the context and then come to what IFC does. So if you look at the identification of the problem, I think we in the last decade in Asia Pacific and India and across the world in the developing countries across Latin America and Africa have clearly identified that affordable housing for the lower income group and the economically weaker section is an issue. I mean, I think that's a well-identified problem that, so there is no question, right? People are not kind of debating whether that's still an issue, right? So that's kind of established. Number two, is there an awareness around it? Absolutely. The fact that we are all, you know, sitting around this table and we've been talking about this across the last 5 years, I would say, is a reflection of the fact that people now recognize this as a, you know, they're aware of this as a problem. Now we come to the implementation, right? So, of course, now that's kind of where one starts looking at what is happening in the market today, right? Or in the country today. Now, across the world, if you look like, or across Asia Pacific, there are schemes that are available in Bangladesh, in, you know, in Pakistan, in India, that are talking about affordable housing, right? But clearly, we're not seeing the implementation, because when you go into these cities, you will still find, you know, urban slums and poor people, you know, in very sort of bad conditions living across the cities. Now, and why are they living in the cities? Because cities are economic engines, right? And that is a critical. So why is it important to understand all of these issues? Because that relates to sort of, you know, the problem in hand. Now we'll just come to, so what IFC has been doing as a part of the World Bank Group is one of the key as sort of two, there are two goals that the World Bank Group, you know, works towards. One is reduction of poverty, and access, the second is access of prosperity to the bottom of the pyramid. Now, this links very closely to the notion of providing housing to the urban poor or the poor, right? And that is why IFC and the World Bank Group collectively has been working on this issue for a long time through mechanisms of one, awareness generation. There are several reports that get published by, you know, the World Bank in identifying the issues, publishing data and metrics on what can be done. You know, the second is looking at what could be done in terms of policy structuring, right? Because, IFC has been working on this for a very long time in supporting the government, you know, across to see what could be the policies that could support in, you know, issues that can lead to better, construction of houses and land availability. And we'll come to that, right? And then the second is looking at, construction, right? So what could be the way one can sort of enable an optimized construction and delivery of these homes? And the third is the availability of financing, right? So that kind of forms the ecosystem of what is required. And the World Bank, group collectively with all its organizations, and IFC has been working on this, you know, for a long time. You know, globally, we have a book of about $1 billion in investments in, you know, the affordable housing sector. In India, we're about 300 million. And we have been working on all different aspects, right? So, for example, we have been facilitating financing, you know, through developer finance, investing in platforms. We've also been structuring very innovative, you know, public-private partnership structures. And also then, you know, investing in financial institutions to look at the supply and demand access of money to, you know, the ecosystem of the housing. So IFC has been working on this for a very long time. In India, we have done lots of different things, and I think we'll probably address that as we go along. But basically, when you're talking about such a large footprint, right, like in India, they did a research done by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs that identified about 20 million, you know, shortage of homes. Now, if you start looking at that and you take some of the metrics that you highlighted by the IGBC, you can see the kind of impact that it has on already, you know, sort of constrained resources, right? I mean, when we talk about housing, we're not just talking about a shelter. We're also talking about access to water, access to waste, you know, the other infrastructure or wastewater, you know, how will the electricity come? And, you know, we're already strapped for all these resources. So as we are building these homes, we have to start seeing what does that mean on already constrained resources and how can we commit to making these housing green? So therefore, the dialogue of green is not separate. I think that anytime we're talking about housing or, you know, we should talk about green affordable housing. Like it should just be, you know, hand in hand with the delivery of affordable homes.
Right. So Shruti, the need is known. I think the need is huge. You know, the need is known. There is a greater degree of awareness in terms of the need of, you know, affordable housing, right? But again, when you look at the implementation of these homes or homes and the infrastructure that, you know, that goes with it, capital is always the constraint, right? And now affordability of green homes has been a big question, right? So green is often thought of as an expensive solution. You know, there are significant upfront investments that are needed. But if you look at the life cycle costs, or if you take a value chain approach, you know, there are significant benefits for all the stakeholders. For the homeowners, you know, there are significant utility savings, better resale value. For the developers, you know, there is product differentiation. For governments, you know, there are opportunities to raise the bar on building regulations. And for investors, you know, the investment risk is lower, right? And all of this leads to a multifold benefit for the planet, right? So what are your thoughts on making, how do you make affordable housing green, right? How do you take affordable housing and make it green?
There are a couple of things, Anup, and I'll try to answer them in sort of a systematic order, but I might just kind of be overlapping. So let's take a step back. One of the first things that you said was the lack of financing, right, or liquidity. I actually think that's not an issue. There is relatively adequate money available in the market. The government has several schemes that are unspent, right? Like we've been talking to the Ministry of Housing, where Amrut and Smart Cities Mission have funding that hasn't been spent by the cities, right? And one of the aspects is, you know, includes affordable housing. Now, why I think the case is that, we'll come to the fact, is that housing, and especially affordable housing, is a fairly complex subject, right? Why? Because it involves land, right? The land availability is a critical one, right? So where, I mean, so you have to understand how, so money as in just liquidity money or getting construction finance is one aspect, right? But if you are building the home, you have to look at other aspects that are just not even discussed, right? So for example, land, where is the land available right now? At what cost to the developer or anyone building these affordable homes, right? And so there has to be structures in place to also look at the land costs, right? The construction costs, right? The construction costs are rising tremendously. Are there, you know, access to technologies? And what are the costs that the technologies are available at, right? And I know that you have a session with some really interesting startups coming in this session. So that's an important aspect to look at the costing, right? The third is the approval process, right? If you look at the costing, when the project is costed, the time for a project to get approval of, you know, from to build and then to sell, it takes a long cycle, right? And those are sunk costs for the developer because they're essentially holding this land and waiting for all the approvals to come across, right? So all of these aspects add to the costing, right? To the overall business and the value proposition of what can one sell the affordable home at, right? So one is the real costing of what would make it affordable, and the other is at what cost should it be available for people who we are bracketing as in the affordable housing range, right? So when you look at that conundrum, like the developer, even if they are really being sort of, you know, upfront and want to sell it, they are stuck, right? Because you can't really, we've seen these issues, right? When land available is in the periphery of the city, which has no social infrastructure, no economic activity, and people are not willing to move there, right? So they end up coming back into the city to live in these sort of urban slums again. So if you look at this, that the dialogue is just not about cost, right? It's about what does it mean to make the project truly affordable and cost efficient, which includes the government's involvement on policies looking at what costs the land is available, where is it available, can there be structures and mechanisms like land pooling, or, you know, what kind of social infrastructure, can there be any subsidies on social infrastructure and transportation, right? That could be structured, right? And what kind of decentralization of economic activities could happen that could lead to people feeling comfortable in the homes they're living in? How long does it take for the approvals to come through? And is that a fair cycle to kind of come through, right? So that's one discussion. Then we come to financing, right? Now, if the developer is spending all of this money on building an affordable homes, what could be the financial instruments that could be structured which help the developer in actually delivering these homes at an affordable value, right? And often that is a challenge. And therefore, there are PPP models that are being structured. Like IFC has done some very excellent examples of PPP across Asia Pacific. There was a project with the Bhubaneswar Development Authority that looked at an EWS housing where a certain percentage of the land was given to the developer to, you know, sort of on a freehold basis to build, middle to high income category homes. And not only and it was interesting because in this model, there was also an operation and maintenance escrow sort of an account created, which ensured the O&M of these projects, because that's also another important part. You don't want these projects to become urban slums, if they're not kept up for a while. So that's the sort of a discussion that's important on the costing side, right? Now, when we start looking at it from a green angle, we at an IFC, we did a study of affordable homes that were green and non-green. And we actually surveyed about 1,000 homes, and we realized that green homes do not cost more. They absolutely don't. And this was a real study. It's available publicly. I'm happy to share it with anyone and share the link. The study that we undertook basically kind of, we created a graph that highlighted green and non-green homes. And our finding was that, number one, green homes don't cost more. So it's absolutely something that we should forget about. The kind of technologies that are available today, for example, I can just tell you, like fly ash brick is readily available, right? Which is, sort of giving you better insulation. It's, using a sort of recyclable material, etc. So there are sort of lots of technologies that are available right now to deliver homes that don't cost more. And the other critical part is that you need to start looking and understanding what green means and incorporating it in your design from the beginning. So if the discussion of going green happens once you kind of design the project and you're ready to construct it, you are going to spend more money in doing it green, because you just simply haven't incorporated the correct kind of daylighting, ventilation, the correct materials to do that. And the third thing I want to highlight is that there are several examples that are available now for making, a lot of new technologies have come up. There is a lot of case studies around that can help you deliver green for your projects. Having said that, in India, currently the penetration of green is very unfortunate and it's only about 5%. So there is a significant...
I'm going to stop you there, Sruthi. So let's look at a low-income family, right? So imagine a 600 square feet home in a peri-urban area, in a rural area. It's going to cost you, 5 to 8 lakhs. So how do you convince somebody like that, to go for a green home? You know, how do you incorporate green products? How do you bring in, green techniques, design practices into the construction of a home?
So, I think the argument is, there's several arguments. Number one is the utility bills, right? On beneficiary-led construction, people end up spending, a decent amount of their salaries on utility bills. And if you do a green housing, you will see reduction in your energy costs, your lighting costs, etc. Number two, it leads to a better sort of an environment, a livable environment for you, right? If you have, a good access to daylighting and, better sort of, ventilation, it's a better thermal comfort that you are creating, which is leads to better livability. And there are a lot of studies that talk about how buildings can impact you, psychologically. So that's the second. The number third is, and in no order, it doesn't cost you more, right? So if it's not going to cost you more, why would you not go green? If it's better for you and better for the planet and better for your generations to come, right? So I think we had done a campaign which said, good for you, good for the planet, which basically meant that not only is it good for you, but it's also good for the planet. The second aspect on the access to technologies, I think that there is a gap there, right? Because I think while there are technologies available, they may not be awareness in the tier two, tier three sort of regions on what are these technologies and how can one access them. And I think there needs to be work done on that. And I know that several entities like ACC and other organizations are kind of working towards reaching to the end clients and talking about how can they make it better.
Okay. So, Sruthi, in the interest of time, I'm moving to the next section now, which is on the role of markets, right? So finance is just not enough, right? I think finance is just one part of the problem, right? One part of the solution for the problem, to the problem. Now, through your work at IFC, you've convened various types of stakeholders and you've developed, very strong partnerships with the government, with the public, with private sectors. And if you see the incentives or the interests of these various parties, they vary considerably, right? So how do you get them all aligned towards a common cause? And can you share some experiences from your ongoing work at IFC?
Yeah, so, IFC did Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was asking, how do you bring them all together and, make them work towards a common cause?
So I can give you a very unique example from IFC, just kind of keep it brief, because IFC actually about 4 years back, created something, convened actually a platform called the Sustainable Housing Leadership Consortium, called the SHLC, which included the 5 top realtor CEOs. So it included Godrej Properties, Tata Realty, Mahindra Life Spaces, Value Budget Housing, and Joyville, Shapurji Palonji. And the CEO signed a charter with IFC. And it also included two leading financial institutions, HDFC, PNB, HFL, and the Government of India was also supportive through Ministry of Housing to look at how one can sectorally impact green homes, right? What could one do? And the SHLC's work plan focused on 3 pillars, policy, technology, financial instruments, and consumer awareness. So this has never happened around the world where 5 sort of, almost real estate sector companies that are building the same kind of homes, sort of competing with each other in the market, right, are actually coming together and having an open sharing of knowledge to see how they can sectorally impact and take the sector into a new direction, right? So that's an example of how one could do an ecosystem, creation with bringing people together on the same platform. And because they understood the importance of green, right? And not only for their, so this is another important thing. Green is all about collaboration. If I'm making a green home and you're not building a green home, it's not going to make a difference, right? I mean, we all have to work together to make it green, right? I mean, because at the end of the day, it's climate change that's impacting the entire world.
Tell us something about the support for innovation. You've been working with a lot of startups who have products for the green world. So what are the different ways in which IFC has been supporting and working with startups and innovative technologies?
Yeah. So, you know, IFC's goal is creating markets, right? And I think that's one of the things that we strongly believe in, the role of creating markets and creating a new economic asset class. For us, affordable housing, not just creating homes, right? But we're creating a new economic asset class in India, right? Now, the way we work on technologies is, one is through ecosystem creation and introduction. As you're aware, we've worked with Shelter Tech. We, through SHLC, introduced some of these, startups to developers for them to pilot their projects, because market feedback is important for commercial viability, right? You need to do pilots. And a lot of time it's a chicken and egg, because these startups are not able to have big developers, pilot their projects and understand what could be the barriers for scale up. So I think that's very critical. And I think that's even more critical than financing, right? Because if you can generate a pipeline on your own, your need and dependency on financing reduces, right? And it also makes you less risky for an investor to invest in if you have successful pilots that have been undertaken. So I think that's one of the things that we've really been working towards, is finding these conversations with the supply and demand side, bringing together the technology providers to the developers or the adopters, and seeing if there could be dialogue facilitation. I can highlight that some of the pilots that some of our through our discussions have been on, the glass fiber reinforced gypsum, a new material that IIT Madras has been working on. We've also looked at the plastic pavers that Shelter Tech has been looking at, or some, also solutions on smart, metering for energy and water. So that's one aspect. The second is, IFC, obviously, based on its mandate, is not able to make small ticket items or Series A kind of, investments. But we do invest in funds of funds that can then facilitate some of these investments. So we've done that. The other is also through providing working capital, through financial institutions. So we are also, we've been working with Tata Cleantech. We're an equity partner in Tata Cleantech. So those are kind of mechanisms that we look at, where we can, bring all these demands together and then facilitate, sort of working capital for some of these companies.
Yeah, I think, we'll hear from some of these startups a little later in the session today. See, we have a couple of questions coming in through the audience. Do you think you want to take some of those questions, and then, we should be able to wrap up with a couple of questions? So there is one from, are you able to see the chat window, Shruti?
Yes, I'm just scrolling down. So the first question is S. Chandar.
Yeah, he says it's almost 20 years to reach 10,000 projects for IGBC, and the growth in the last 5 years has been a high major reason due to the RERA Act, FSI rebate, which means builders are going green for financial incentives from government, but not pulled from customers with respect to affordable housing. So how will it work, and can we wait for 20 years? I think, so he's just looking at the future of, how things will pan out.
That's what I'm trying to say. I think the discussion is not whether green should be done because it's a pull from the customers, right? I mean, I think it should be something that's done because the developers also see a brand positioning in that. They see a sort of a corporate commitment on that. And, one of the surveys we undertook as a part of this larger survey, which was a post-occupancy survey, we also surveyed people who, were living in green homes and who were not living in green homes and wanting green homes. And there is a significant population of people in the affordable housing sector that are now aware of green homes and the savings that gives to them. And it does, leads to sort of better sale values and resale values, right? So I think the market is changing. It took how the first step always takes longer and then the short steps to take. The next question is, could you elaborate on why green homes are not more expensive? I actually did that in my discussion, but merely because now the access to technologies is, a lot of technologies which are green are becoming available at a lower cost. And, there have been like air conditioners that are more efficient, appliances, building materials. So the cost of and green is coming down further, right? And the awareness is also, and it absolutely story housing and individual housing. And we are happy to share information on that if you need, right? The next question is, few government agencies, for instance, MMRDA, have built houses for the displaced people for many years. If the green homes do not cost more, what stops the government from adopting greener options? You're absolutely right. So the many, see, obviously the information asymmetry is being addressed now, right? So we're now getting more and more information on how green doesn't cost more. A lot of houses that are green now, like we're working in Tamil Nadu through the World Bank Group, you know, in through a fund called the Shelter Fund with the Tamil Nadu Infrastructure Fund Management Corporation. And it's going to be, you know, there's a critical component of green included in that. So increasingly now, there has been a wave in adopting green and establishing the fact that it doesn't cost more.
So Shruti, I'm getting a ping from the host saying that, you know, we have exceeded our time. So I think, you know, we will wrap up our session. Any concluding remarks that you want to share with everybody today?
I mean, I just want to kind of be very brief. So thank you, you know, Anup, for this session, and thank you again, Habitat for Humanity, and, you know, and Sankalp, and everybody else who's joined in. I just, you know, want to reiterate the fact that green affordable housing does not cost more, and it's good for you, it's good for the planet, and we all have to work together as an ecosystem to deliver it. If we keep saying that, you know, it should be a consumer or the developer should do it, or there is not enough financial instruments, or the government should do it, we'll be talking about the same things again another 10 years from now, and probably the problem would be even worse than what we're living now, right? So the climate change is there. Have to tackle it collectively, and we can. We have the ability, and housing provides that very, very interesting convergence of sustainable development goals, you know, of what our commitment individually is to us and our future. So I think that we should really commit ourselves to delivering and living in green affordable homes. So thank you for this discussion.
Yeah, thank you, Shruti. It's always a pleasure to learn from you every time. And we thank you all once again for joining us today for this session. Thank you. Over to you, Meera.
Thank you,
Shruti, and thank you, Anup, for that. It was, you know, there's a whole lot of work that IFC is doing, and it's always fascinating. And Shruti has always been a supporter of the work that we do with the Shelter Tech program as well. So, you know, really wonderful to have you. So we'll move on to the next part, which is, you know, the speech by Dr. Shailesh Agarwal, who's the executive director of BMTPC. You know, he has been with the organization since 2008. His main role is working on this affordable housing for all through the PMAY scheme. And through that, they provide, you know, it's a very technical organization, and they work on promoting emerging technologies for faster and sustainable housing development. So he's comes from a, you know, very strong technical background, and, you know, you can look him up. Amazing energetic personality, and he's involved in a whole lot of things. And as you know, things may happen with the government. Unfortunately, he could not join this afternoon, but he was kind enough to share a message, you know, including all the work that the government is doing. So we will play that video, and he said that, you know, he's always available to support us in any way, and you know, many of the startups that you will hear from later also are guided by him in one way or the other. So I request that the video be played. I will stop screen share. Okay, so while we wait for that bit.
The audio is not there. Yeah.
Can I have one minute? I'm just checking.
Yes.
Okay. So BMTPC, as you may be aware, is doing a lot of technical work in promoting innovative solutions. They are also the technology partner for this government program called the Global Housing Technology Challenge.
I extend very warm welcome.
Now we hear him. Okay, I'm just going to start now. Meera? Yeah.
Welcome to all the participants, dignitaries, experts, attendees, to this Sankalp Virtual 2020 session. I, Dr. Shailesh Kumar Agarwal, represent Building Materials and Technology Promotion Council, an organization under the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs mandated to promote and transfer resource-efficient, climate-responsive, disaster-resilient, sustainable and affordable building materials and construction systems for field-level applications. We also act as a bridge to take sustainable solutions from academic institutions to the field, that is lab to lab. As you know, technology transfer is an involved process requiring a number of steps, such as sourcing of potential technologies, R&D efforts for adaptation of technologies to suit local conditions, prototype development, validation, certification, patenting, standardization, commercialization, dissemination, training, skill upgradation, and field application. Believe me, we at BMTPC work in all these areas along with our ministry, and some of our recent initiatives I would like to shed some light on. But before embarking upon the activities, let me just tell you that India is undergoing rapid urbanization. While 31% of India's population live in urban areas as per census 2011, this number is expected to grow to 40% by 2030, with a contribution of 75% of India's GDP. Large sections of society are migrating to urban areas for better job opportunities and quality of life from rural areas. These cities need to provide a receptive, innovative, and productive environment which can promote faster and sustainable growth, ensuring a better quality of living. Hence, it is imperative to have a comprehensive strategy to fulfill the rising demand in the housing sector. Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India, launched Pradhanmantri Awas Yojana Urban, or you can call it Housing for All, in 2015 to provide housing for all by the year 2022 is the year when nation will be celebrating 75th year of its independence. Under this scheme, against a validated demand of 11.2 million houses, which are to be constructed by 2022, about 10.8 million houses have already been sanctioned by our ministry till date, out of which 3.2 million houses have been handed over to beneficiaries. About 6.8 million houses are under construction, out of which 1.5 million houses are using innovative and alternative technologies. Within the ambit of overarching Pradhanmantri Awas Yojana Urban, a technology submission has also been set up, which facilitates the adoption of innovative, sustainable, eco-friendly, and disaster-resilient technologies and building materials for low-cost, speedier, and quality construction of houses. Typically, conventional construction systems such as use of brick and mortar are slow-paced, energy-intensive, and dependent on natural resources and have a large carbon footprint. The entry of innovative and alternate construction technologies in India has been gaining usage, and while these technologies have entered the market, its acceptance and adoption needs to be enhanced. For this, a concerted effort is required to create mass awareness to accept a technology transition from conventional to new technologies through lighthouse projects, expositions, and other outreach methods that will mainstream its uses. Further, to give fillip to these innovative construction systems, the Honorable Prime Minister envisaged the importance of adoption of new and innovative construction technologies to improve the pace and quality of work under Pradhanmantri Awas Yojana Urban to address the challenges of rapid urban growth and its attendant requirements. Construction of houses at this scale is an opportunity for inviting alternate technologies from across the globe to trigger a major transition through the introduction of cutting-edge technologies, building materials, and processes. Accordingly, our ministry conducted Global Housing Technology Challenge India, which we call GHTC India, with the aim to identify and mainstream a basket of innovative construction technologies from across the globe for housing construction sector that are sustainable, eco-friendly, and disaster resilient. These technologies are to be cost-effective and speedier while enabling the quality construction of houses, meeting diverse geoclimatic conditions of India and desired functional needs. Future technologies are also being supported under GHTC India to foster an environment of research and development in the country. Through GHTC India, we aspire to develop an in a holistic manner. As part of GHTC India, an ExpoCom conference called Construction Technology India 2019 was organized on 2nd and 3rd March 2019 at Vigyan Bhavan, New Delhi. The Expo was inaugurated by Honorable Prime Minister of India and brought together multiple stakeholders involved in innovative and alternate housing technologies for exchange of knowledge and business opportunities through an exhibition, thematic sessions, panel discussions, and masterclasses. Overall, Construction Technology India 2019 had participation of about 2,500 delegates from 32 countries and more than 3,500 visitors at the exhibition. 54 exhibitors with 32 innovative technologies from 25 countries were in display with more than 150 stalls. 54 technology providers with 32 new technologies from 25 countries, including technologies from USA, Finland, Australia, Spain, France, South Korea, and Italy were evaluated by the Technology Evaluation Committee. A total of 78 potential future technology providers from across the country, with 55 post-prototype and 23 pre-prototype, made their presentations to the expert jury during the event. Through GHTC India, we shortlisted 54 proven demonstrable technologies, which are further divided into six broad categories, which I would like to name here. One is precast concrete construction system, known as 3D precast volumetric construction. Precast concrete construction system, which is precast components being assembled at the site. Third is light gauge steel structure systems and pre-engineered steel structure systems, prefabricated sandwich panel systems, monolithic concrete construction, and sixth one is stay-in-place formwork system. Now, six lighthouse projects consisting of about 1,000 houses, each with physical and social infrastructure facilities, is being constructed at six places across the country. These projects will showcase the use of these six distinct shortlisted innovative technologies for field-level applications, learning, and application. LHPs will demonstrate and deliver ready-to-live mass housing at an accelerated pace as compared to conventional brick and mortar construction, and will be more economical, sustainable, of high quality and durability. These projects will also serve as live laboratories for all stakeholders, including R&D organizations, leading to successful transfer of technologies from lab to the field. The GHTC India Challenge also sought to promote future potential technologies through incubation support and accelerator workshops in order to foster an environment of research and development in the country. And accordingly, Affordable Sustainable Housing Accelerator India, we call it ASHA India, has been launched with the prime objective of nurturing upcoming Indian individuals or technology ventures in the field of construction technology in the housing sector in their startup phase by providing all the support necessary to help entrepreneurs establish themselves before they scale up their ventures and to support entrepreneurs translating innovations into products and services that are commercially viable. Under ASHA India initiative, incubation and accelerator support is being provided to potential future technologies that are not yet market ready or the technologies that are market ready. The ASHA India centers are being set up at four IITs, namely IIT Bombay, IIT IIT Roorkee, and also at the CSIR laboratory, CSIR NIST, Jorhat, and CBRI Roorkee. These centers will help in developing design guidelines, construction manuals, and other necessary guidelines relevant for effective use of such technologies in the region. Potential future technologies in the category will also be accelerated with the objective of providing rapid and strategic learning and a platform for exposure, networking, and business opportunity. This acceleration support will be done by the ministry through BMTBC and in collaboration with our knowledge partners of Global Housing Technology Challenge. Apart from Global Housing Technology Challenge India activities, through which a basket of 54 proven demonstrable construction system is created, and my ministry through BMTBC is also operating performance appraisal certification scheme called PECS, which authorizes BMTBC to assess and certify any innovative material, product, and system so that innovations in the sector can be mainstreamed. Primarily, BMTBC's certification comes very handy for the innovations on which new standards are yet to be developed and can be considered as B-standard. It is a handy tool to foster growth of innovations in the construction sector. Through this platform, I invite all the innovators to visit our website and see the relevant details. In order to create enabling environment for proliferation of innovations, there are two major impediments, particularly for the government sector. One is absence of standards and certification, and second is absence of schedule of rates. BMTBC works hand in hand with BIS, a national standardization agency, for inclusion of new technologies in these standards, and CPWD, a national construction agency, for development of schedule of rates. I'm happy to share with the audience that all 54 technologies identified through challenge are included by CPWD for their works, and their SORs are being developed. Another step for dissemination of new systems taken under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban is demonstration construction using new technologies in different parts of India. BMTBC is operating this demonstration housing project scheme, and so far projects comprising of 40 demonstration houses along with infrastructure have been taken at several places using distinct technologies. During the construction, regular handholding and capacity building programs are being organized not only for the professionals but also for artisans, policymakers, and students of architecture and engineering. BMTBC also provides handhold support to the states interested in implementing new technologies in their respective states in terms of identification of technologies as per requirement, preparation of procurement documents, quality control and assurance manuals, and its implementation. I'm happy to share that more than 1.5 million houses are being constructed using new technologies in different states under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban. Further, in order to catalyze the market for affordable housing, our ministry has been encouraging large public agencies like housing boards, railways, defense, and public sector units to undertake construction of their projects using emerging technologies for their employees and other housing projects. My ministry and BMTBC on regular basis conducts capacity building programs in these states on best construction practices and emerging technologies, and publish documents, literature, manuals to create technical framework for such systems. Indian subcontinent being vulnerable to a variety of natural hazards such as earthquakes, cyclones, landslides, floods, we at ministry are also committed towards disaster mitigation management in all the mission mode programs. BMTBC's Vulnerability Atlas of India, its third edition, was released by Honorable Prime Minister on 2nd March 2019. The Vulnerability Atlas of India is a unique document which collates information on various hazards up to district level and also projects vulnerability of existing housing stock. Recently, e-course on Vulnerability Atlas of India in collaboration with SPA, School of Planning and Architecture, has New Delhi has been started, which aims to empower the citizens of India on disaster-related information and take proactive measures. As regards new technologies, we are of considered view that education regarding these new systems need to be imparted at the graduate and undergraduate levels in the colleges. To make it happen, we are contemplating to start a certificate course on innovative construction technologies with SPA New Delhi, and later the course will be shared with all education institutes so that it can be included in their academic curriculum. Apart from this, we are also using IEC as an effective tool for wider advocacy and better outreach. Our websites can be visited for getting all information about new technologies, current projects, and other technical details. all are encouraged to visit our websites to get more useful information. It is the motto of present government to work on the theme of reform, perform and transform. We invite all of you to be part of India's growth story and bring innovations in the construction sector with the objective of creating clean, green, sustainable, affordable and resilient society. Jai Hind. Thank you.
Meera, over to you. Meera.
Sorry, I was muted. Apologies that he could not join today. So please do share your questions in the chat. I will pass it on to him and get answers. There are lots of exciting work they are doing. So, you know, it'll be interesting to follow them. And as he suggested, check their webpage as well. So we'll move on to the last session. We are going a little behind schedule, but, you know, hopefully we'll catch up on the time. I would like to invite Deepak Vishwanathan, who is a senior technical consultant with Habitat for Humanity International. He comes with a vast technology background as well. And he has been with Habitat for Humanity India Trust prior to working with the Terwilliger Center. And in his earlier life, he was in the Navy. Over to you, Deepak. And I would just, you know, briefly put up this slide on what's in store. So Deepak will be giving a bit of an overview and moderating a session with five startups, each presenting their solution and then, you know, some discussions on the green and sustainability aspects of it. So over to you, Deepak.
Thank you, Meera. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can.
Okay, thanks. So we're good to go. I'll start with a brief introduction to Habitat for Humanity International Terwilliger Center. It's a leading development of park systems to make available, accessible, affordable, and alternative building materials and services to the low-income poor. As part of the program, we also run a shelter tech accelerator. It seeks to identify, shortlist, and thereafter mentor startups in the construction space. We seek innovators with great ideas, with good teams, who are able to lead their businesses. We, in turn, provide mentoring support, mentoring from the industry, and support as required. So today on the panel, I'll start with the introductions. We have Tarun Kumar, who is the co-founder and CEO of EcoSTP, a unique biodigester-based sewage treatment facility. We have Hasit Ganatra from Rematerials or Modroof, a co-founder. We have Aditya Jain, who is the co-founder of Tavasta Manufacturing Solutions. They do additive manufacturing that's also called 3D printing. The Recycler India, called Salt Tech Design Lab, is the CEO and co-founder. And last but not the least, Priyanka Gupta from KBSS, who unfortunately was not able to attend. So we have Mr. Tejinder Kumar representing Kaushal Bhav Skills Solutions. He's the lead in skills and knowledge from KBSS. So without further ado, I would like to hand over the screen to Mr. Tarun Kumar to lead us through EcoSTP's technology and business plans.
Hello all, can you see my screen?
Yeah, thank you,
Tarun.
Yes, we can.
Yeah, screen. Okay. All right. Good afternoon. I'll straight jump in. I have 5 minutes. Let's start with the snow. Have you all seen the Bangalore snow? Anyone? Most people in Bangalore have seen this. This is not snow. It's a filth. It's a snowflakes from the sewage that comes over. In most places in Bangalore, it is like this. Sometimes it goes as high as 1 meter, 2 meter, and you have to just drive through that. So that's how the flakes are. So I'll show you another one, which is my favorite picture. This is my lake that's catching fire. So this lake, known as the Bangalore-Barthur Lake, it burns every 6 months or 1 year. Last time it burned for 14 hours a year back. Why I'm showing this picture is, this is very close to me because I live near this lake. So I'm personally impacted. So that's why my journey started. So last time it burned for, like I said, 14 hours. And it's a lake. Imagine a lake that is burning, right? The reality. So what we did is we got the government to douse it. The government could not douse it. And then we got the military to douse it. So military, the Jawans came, some 5,000 Jawans. They came in helicopters, poured water. Many got bitten by snakes. Somehow they managed to douse it. Now, why is burning? Why the lake is burning? That's the question is burning because of the sewage that comes in. Something like 80% of Bangalore, 80, when the flush, it straight comes to the lake. Why? We are not that bad guys to dump in the lake, but we're not lucky like Chennai or Mirai there or Bombay, wherein there's a sea. So there's no sea in Bangalore. So it has to go to a drain, and all drain leads to the lake. So that's a situation. So we said, guys, okay, now this nice looking, we have to solve this problem. We can keep on complaining, blame the politicians. And there's a great old saying that don't curse the darkness, light a candle. How do you light a candle? What you can do about it? And we found that one of the biggest issues are the STPs, the sewage treatment plants in the city is broken. And only way we can stop the fire, only way we can stop the foam is by having STPs, sewage treatment plants. Now that also is broken. Something like the minister saying 70% of the STPs are broken, 70. So what we do? And they're broken because it is runs on chemicals, motors, filters, power. And that's why it is broken. So we said, is there any way we can solve this problem? So, and there are billions of research and dollars going into a better mousetrap, better STPs. So how do you solve the problem? We said, okay, let's go back to nature. Let's see, ask nature, how did we solve it? So we went to learning from nature, and we found there's an organism called called anaerobic bacteria, which is prevalent in septic tanks, prevalent in cow stomach, which are the original nature scavengers. So we thought we'll leverage that and see how we can work it out. And we got a lot of help across the world. Since we are powered by purpose, so we have a lot of help across the world. So one help came from Biomimicry Institute. In fact, we have a stall, virtual stall with Biomimicry here. Was how do you learning from nature, how the techniques? And one of the examples, very popular examples of biomimicry is the bullet train. The old, good old bullet trains had a flat face, which used to make a lot of noise. And they copied the, copy is the right word, the kingfisher's beak, and then the noise went off. Another great example is Velcro. So another nature-based innovation. We also got inspired by the Steve Jobs. I mean, everyone, the Steve Jobs last quote from the hospital, he spoke about the intersection of biology and technology. So how do you learn from nature and how do you solve this problem? So that's how it is. So this is our product. Is based on a cow stomach. Cow stomach is an anaerobic digestion machine. It can digest even cellulose. Everything gets digested in a cow stomach. Unlike a human stomach, it works on enzymes. So cow stomach or any ruminant stomach has got 4 chambers. So same thing we copied in a civil structure. So no moving parts. You put bad water in, you put good water out. Water flows through multiple chambers. We inoculate with the custom anaerobic bacteria. The water flows through multiple pipes. Very simple mechanism, but very, very clever engineering. Multiple stages. We did several years of research and we got it perfected. We got a patent and it now is deployed at many places in India. And that's our innovation. And this is how the cow stomach, the gut will look like. So called the gut of STP. So a lot of pipes, a lot of intricacies. We don't make the STP. We only give the license. So STPs are made locally at remote. That's why we are very, very sustainable. We don't make the box and ship it across. So we give the license and someone makes the STP at remote. So from Bangalore, we support all over India. We have in Assam, Delhi, they all make the STPs locally using local material, local labor, as per the instructions given from the centrally. So we have a DIY kit, do-it-yourself kit. So what we say is buy the kit from us, the EcoSP kit from us, add your concrete and STP is ready. And what is STP is ready means, this is how it looks like. It's a building, it's an apartment, and you walk in there, that's STP. which we call is built for generations, is all as natural as you can get. No moving parts, no chemicals, no sound. And the plants you see, the edge are the last stage treatment. So it's also natural. This is how it looks like. There's another example, it's a children's playground. It's another of my favorite. So kids are playing around. Below that is STP. It's completely quite natural. And this is what it is. So we integrate along with the apartments and buildings. So the urban environment, as you all know, is exploding. The cities are exploding. So instead of putting a power-based, hungry, motor-based STP, which doesn't work, or maximum works 1 year, 2 year, we are in India now started. We have over 50 projects now all over India. We integrate this along with the new buildings that are coming up. So contributing to the less foam or less fire. Eventually, you want to stop the fire. Maybe that will take longer time. Key features are no load, minimum load, no power required, and we have all the PCB approvals, no smell at all, and no return on ROI is less than 2 years, and absolutely no operators. Well, that's my short slide. This is how my STP looks like, the kiddies playground. This is how it looks like. Below that, STP is part of the system. And what drives us, our purpose is, our mission is to reclaim every single drop of wastewater naturally, and that's what helps us. That's why all of you are here, and that's how even the experts who come in, the staff that comes in, this is what powers us to come up every single day and perform, is our mission. Well, that's all I have.
Thank you. Thank you, Tarun. That was very, very precise, concise, and well put out. May I call Hasit to come on, share his screen, take us through rematerials?
I'll stop the screen share.
Yes.
Thank you, Hasit. You're on. If you could share your screen and.
Yeah. Okay, can you? Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Deepak. Thank you, Sankalp. Thank you, Habitat. I'm Hasit Ganatra. I'm founder of Rematerials. And we are a roofing company. We have developed this unique modular eco-friendly roofing solution. We call it ModRoof. And roofing has been a unique product. We have seen it through our journey. But then why did we start this? So our motivation has been the research we did in early part of the company in 2013, 2014, we traveled across 4 states of India. We understood the housing situation in detail, and we found that a very large population, not just in India, but across the world, they live under corrugated cement and metal sheets. The living conditions are very hot. There's water leakage. They break and they contain toxic materials. So we decided to do something about it. Of course, there's concrete roof, but it's so much more expensive. There's no quality control. It's very unorganized. And so this became our starting point. We wanted to develop a better roofing. We realized that roofing is the most basic element of shelter. So we set about doing this and here are some of the results. So we've installed more than 500 roofs now. In and around Ahmedabad, where we are based, but also in other cities in India. Families are able to sleep on top, fly kites on top, put water tank on top, install solar on top, do a lot of activities on top. I think we have reached a point now where our roof is modular, very fast to install, and I'll come to that. But it's also load bearing, so we also allow people to build a whole another floor on top, So that has been the newest development, and it's turning out to be quite revolutionary for us. I think, but behind the scenes, how we develop it, what we do, this slide captures it. We have innovated on a lot of materials. We have developed materials from waste cardboard, natural fiber, so it becomes a natural fiber composite, successfully made it waterproof and installed roofs from that. We're moving in the direction of even more robust materials and robust manufacturing processes. We realized we needed to mass produce that material. So moving towards biopolymers and mixing it with waste and installing roofs using that in near future. We partnered with microfinance companies because we realized that when we sell to poor, we are selling a very high quality roof. It ends up being 80,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees on an average. It's size dependent and they can't pay everything upfront. So we started to partner with microfinance companies. So they pay 2,000, 3,000 rupees a month, and they're able to get a very high quality shelter, high quality roof. Of course, we do other segments also now. We have installed roofs over private schools and hospitals and shops also. One of my favorite parts, you know, of the roof is the modularity. You know, it's just, I think we want to scale. We want to install the roof over as many houses across the world as possible. So roof is very easy to transport. It's very easy to, you know, install. You know, locals can install it. It's, I think 6 to 10 times faster to install than RCC, but it gives the same properties, build another floor on top. It's designed as per the same RCC standards. And of course, you know, repair and maintenance is very easy. So this is this slide captures, you know, the essence of what we do. I think we have a lot more things coming up. You know, our roof currently is, I think, 91% recyclable at the end of life. But we have certain, become better at it. We're very interested in, you know, improving quality of life inside the house and do whatever it takes. So energy is a very, you know, big interest area. We've already successfully prototyped solar embedding in the roofing panels, roofing tiles. So we hope to launch this in later part of next year. Full house, of course, is very important too. So we are in the process of even deploying. We have developed it already, but we'll launch it in again later half of next year. So yeah, that's it. I think thank you so much for the opportunity, and yeah, we are truly committed to providing shelter to the world, and very thankful to Habitat for being part of this journey. Thank you.
Thank you. That was very interesting. And having schools ourselves, I vouch for their sturdiness, their aesthetic look, and for serving the purpose in an eco-friendly manner. I'll circle back to you with a couple of questions as we get them. May I now invite Aditya Jain from Tawastha Manufacturing Solutions to come on, share his screen, and lead us through his technology.
Just a moment. Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Aditya, and thank you, Habitat. Thank you, Sankalp, for having me here. I hope you can see my screen. So we started this company about 3 years back to focus on construction using automated technologies, and we want to disrupt the construction sector using our 3D printing technology. So if you look at the construction industry and its evolution over the past several decades, or even going even before that, it has primarily, almost remain the same with very minimal involvement of automation and technologies, and hence cost cutting has been a very difficult thing to achieve here. Almost every other industry, if you look at automotive industry as a comparison, in a person's life, a house is the single most valuable asset that a person owns, and the automotive or the car is the second most important asset that a person owns. The automotive industry has gone very far ahead by involving automation and other technologies, whereas construction industry has stayed where it is. So we wanted to bring in digital automation and cost cutting and provide housing to a far more number of people than who can afford it now, and provide good quality housing. So this is the vision with which we started working. We wanted to create a tangible improvement in the life of individuals by providing a dignified shelter. And in India, we require about 100 million homes by 2030. That is an estimate that has been come up. But the world itself requires better housing for about 1.5 billion people. Not all of these people are homeless. They need better homes than what they currently have. And this is something that we want to achieve by using modern automation, digital technologies, and with the involvement of 3D printing, which builds a structure or an object layer by layer. So I'll just show you a brief video for you to understand how the technology works, and then probably we can go into how we are doing our projects, etc. So we have built the 3D printer, the materials that go into it. We have also built the software and the process technologies that are used to build our houses. So this is a 3D printer in action. Our 3D printer is currently hosted in Chennai. We have what is called offsite factory method at this point of time. So the machine itself is hosted within a larger factory. We print it as modules and then assemble, but we are also working on an on-site 3D printer. It will be ready by March 2021, and we will be carrying out on-site 3D printing as well. So we feel that off-site 3D printing and on-site 3D printing have its own advantages, and we are actually pushing ahead with both. So the key problems that we are planning to solve using our 3D printing technology, one is affordability. So construction industry is notoriously opaque, and due to the opaqueness of the industry, there is an affordability in the market. There is a problem with respect to financing as well when price varies in the same geography for the same design. So we want to bring in affordability by bringing in transparency within the construction industry, and also by through automation, reducing the overall cost of construction. And 3D printing technology is very customizable. So every single house can be different from the previous one in terms of size, shape, design, and we can still 3D print it with almost the same cost advantage. Sustainability, we use several sustainable materials within our cement and our concrete mix already, such as fly ash, silica fume. And we are also trying to come up with certain materials that reduce the amount of cement used within the overall material to a very large extent. So we have been trying with something called LC3 cement, which is a low carbon footprint cement. We're also trying out a few new materials, which we'll unveil over a period of time. So one of the key problems, especially in the Indian construction industry, is low productivity of labor. So this is something that we are enhancing using our technology. Robustness, this is something that we are extremely passionate about, that is building urban quality infrastructure in rural areas. So if you look at modern construction technologies, technologies such as precast have not stepped outside the urban environment because they require a minimal scale. So our focus is to build micro factories which can move from place to place, enabling affordable housing even in rural areas using technology-led construction. Speed is a key aspect that we are working on. Our aim is to get to a point where we can build a complete house, including finishing within a week, and finish the superstructure in 3 days. We are a little far away from that, but we are moving towards it. By next year, we want to reduce it to less than 2 weeks and then move towards less than 3 days, as I mentioned. So Habitat has been supporting us all across our journey. And we were part of the Shelter Tech Accelerator. And through the Tevi Legal Center, we got catalytic support for building an affordable house in Chennai, inside IIT Madras campus. This project will be unveiled very shortly. We had a few delays due to COVID, but we are soon inaugurating India's first 3D printed house. And we are quickly moving towards printing G+3 structures and taller structures. Initially, these structures will be based on offsite technology. But moving forward, we'll be bringing in on-site multi-story construction as well. Our next on-site printer that I mentioned, which will be unveiled in 2021, will be capable of doing G+1, and then we'll be moving higher. So toilet construction is one of the key areas that we intend to focus on. We have been working with several companies in this domain, and our aim is to get to a point where we can build a toilet module in less than 6 hours and move the printer across various places so that it can be built much easier. So we're also building a robust ecosystem of partners. We work with cement companies and also several construction companies to integrate our 3D printing process into India's construction industry. So this is a brief on what we work on. I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you, Aditya. Very interesting. And you're at the cutting edge or the frontiers of technology, and we are happy to be with you, supporting you get the first 3D printed house up and ready. Thank you so much. May I now call, I'll circle back to you for questions. Sure, may I call Aditya Shukla from Recycler India Soltech to share screen and tell us something more about waste to wealth.
So my screen is visible to everybody?
Yes Aditya, please go ahead.
Yeah. So hello, everybody. My name is Aditya. I am founder and CEO of Soil Design Labs. So basically, we created a brand name called Recycler India, under which we deploy systems to convert waste into valuable products. And the first thing when you see a dump site or a landfill site comes into your mind is a poor waste management or ever-growing waste. But what I will tell you is the underlying reason for that is because of a core problem related to the infrastructure around it. So one of the core problem is lacking of recycling technologies to convert heterogeneous waste or mix of waste from multiple segments and sources. The second one is what you will do with the waste which you have procured and recovered and manufactured them into a product, where the product will go, what are the market for the product. So these are the reasons. The third one is the amount of waste which is being generated and the amount which is being converted into some products. The recycling ratio, what we call it, or percentage of recycling is very less because of there is no availability of the use case for the recycled product or the market for them. So that's the issue around what we are working on. And if you see, what we do is like, we have come up with a technology-driven solution with the existing supply chain. And what we are doing is we are integrating our technology in the existing supply chain to convert waste, and that too with a minimum segregation or no segregation as such, and use as much as amount of waste coming in from municipal solid waste or industrial waste and convert them to a product which has a market demand or which use case in terms of applications. So our technology is basically to convert mixed plastic waste using as a binding material, then different kinds of industrial waste as per the availability or the geographic location, like as filler or agri material. Then you do a compatibilizing and a composition process. Basically, that's a patented technology where we use different kinds of compatibilizers and copolymers to homogenize this mixed plastic, and we convert them into a polymer composite building material thereon to convert them into the products. And if you see what advantage we bring with the technology is basically, if you see existing technologies, end of life cycle disposal systems and other different technologies, they have high CO2 emission like incineration or conversion. And if they do not have high CO2 emission, recycling efficiency is very less, such as conventional mechanical recycling process. So in terms of technology, we reduce 60 to 80% of CO2 coming out from the process of recycling or the production of new virgin materials. We use 0% water in the manufacturing process. So there is no water inside the product as such going into the component of manufacturing. Very low onboard energy. Then we use mixed plastic waste as the processing binder. And we use low process industrial waste. So that's the advantage we are bringing apart from recycling plastic waste. And the type of product we make is basically focused on a section and infrastructure segment. And to be very subdomain of that is to affordable housing and low cost housing segment, because there the issue remains the same. The three key issues are high material cost, high cost of labor to make the houses, everything. So which directly impacts the performance of the house to be built or to be made. So therefore, we are coming up with a composite product which are like high in performance property, economical and price competitive to cement concrete counterparts, can be scaled for mass consumption and have multiple applications like flooring, roofing and walling products. And the products are made in recast and modular shapes in factory made. So it can be easy to install and get at site with very minimum less skilled labors, and it can have multiple uses applications as such. If you kind of see the impact we are providing with the technologies on the multiple fronts, but to be very precise, the three segments are like carbon reduction, employment and livelihood generation, construction and infrastructure. So in CO2 emission, if we recycle 1 ton of our material from plastic and industrial waste, we are somewhere around 0.93 metric ton of carbon equivalent we are offsetting. And if you see the employment generation, the one factory, so model is into a micro enterprise model where each factory will be established, which can convert waste into products. So one factory can employ a direct labor from 10 to 14 people, then functional staff of 6 to 8, then indirect employment can come different kinds of people who are associated in waste value chain, like waste worker, rag pickers. It can range from 60 people to 130 people in one city for the one factory, for the supply chain. So that's the other. The last part is construction infrastructure segment. We are reducing the product pricing and the kind of cost of the product we are making by 10 to 30%. We are providing the precast product in such a way that if you see the overall life cycle value in terms of transportation of the material to the site, installation, labor, and the average aging life cycle and the performance over the aging life cycle, we are somehow saving 30 to 50% in terms of time and cost for the product. Our efforts are very much focused on 8, 9, 11, 13, and 15 sustainable development goals for 2030. And our model is fairly simple. What we have developed is a technology, and there needs to be an exploitation of this technology into multiple segments because the problem is very big. The amount of waste being generated into decentralized form into different cities, the problem is huge. And the kind of demand in the market for affordable housing or low cost housing or the shelter is also huge. And we cannot fill all those things in from the one place or the one centralized way. Therefore, our model is a decentralized model in which we are enabling micro enterprises to establish this kind of technology in a commercial way where they can source material like waste and different kinds of industrial waste or municipal waste and convert them into product, and those product can be utilized locally or indigenously for the different built up purposes. So that's the scale up model what we are assuming. And if you see where we stand from is we are a forward integrating model for the existing waste management systems, and we are a backward integrating model to existing building material and supplying systems. So that's where the Saltech comes in with the technology. Thank you.
Thank you, Aditya. I find this effort really commendable. I mean, using waste material to build something which is usable. May I now request Tejinder from BSS to lead us through the presentation sent by Priyanka. Tejinder?
Deepak, should we request Sankalp to play the video?
Yes. Tejinder is playing it, as I had discussed with him. If he's unable, he will respond. Give him a minute.
Sure. Meera ma'am, I request you to kindly share the video because I am not able to say it on my screen. For Deepak sir, you can do it later.
Okay, thank you, Tejinder. Meera, could you request Sankalp to Sankalp, play?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I will play it right now. Seeking accreditation.
The voice is not audible suddenly.
Yes.
And they also won Innovation Award in Mainstreaming Traditional Building Practices to Skilling and Certification at Asia Pacific Housing Forum held in India in 2019. We have developed assets for us in last 5 years through skilling, construction material and construction technology. We are the pioneer organization in formalizing the course curriculum named Junior Heritage MSc and got it accredited through Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. We have in situ 560 GHMs available in Rajasthan. And as an initial step, we have trained 31 junior heritage mistries in Odisha for construction of the 12 houses. We use lime masonry practice, that is lime stabilized soil block and lime concrete column technology for construction of energy efficient homes, which is the combination of design and the material. Our technology has been accepted by urban local bodies in Rajasthan and Odisha, and we have developed progress tracking tool for our clients to track the progress of the construction site. Our single unit dwelling construction work finishes in 30 days, and our construction technology reduces carbon footprints up to 86%. This is a single unit plan where we ensure that the view factor between wall and the occupant is increased to the design and thermal comfort is ensured through thermal mass and the finish. We use stone roof with lime sulky finish. This is a scheme visualization plan for Odisha for our current work, where you can see the floor finish level for the bed is about 6 inches. And for sitting is about 1.6 inches. These are the three section plans created for three regions we are working in 2022. That is Zone 3, Zone 4, and Zone 5, which is Odisha, Rajasthan, and Meghalaya. The design and the technology is contextualized as per the requirement of the regions. For instance, the deck low over the roof is lighter in zone 5 as compared to zone 4 and 3 because of the disaster prevalence and the requirements of the topography. Also, the foundation plan as you see here is different being created according to the region. We have submitted a white paper on fighting COVID-19 in urban slums to Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs to integrate our recommendations to the housing issue. There is a clear emerging relationship on the strategic partnership to meet the needs of the housing. The risk that we foresee is the adaptability of the policy at the state level, and the challenges in our business model would require cost-benefit analysis and the retaining of the morphology of urban or slums and rural living. The core team of KBSS comprises of Lakshman Shankar, myself, and Tejin. Shankar brings technical knowledge of lime stabilized soil block and lime concrete block, and the cluster community design supported by my experience of bringing synergies between the multiple stakeholders and hectic operations. Tejin is a torchbearer at the field level, wherein he executes the community initiative and spatial planning of the housing projects. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tejinder. Okay, we are now cycling back for questions. My first question would be to Tarun from EcoSTP. Tarun, if you can hear me.
Yeah, I can hear you well.
Okay, you showed us some horrible scenes from the lakes of Bangalore, which include things like fires and foam. So I just wanted to ask you the context of sustainability sewage treatment. I mean, how do you connect the two? And you talk about no moving parts, etc. And I also want to understand what is the acceptability and affordability of such technologies vis-a-vis conventional ones.
Yeah. So to start with, the government has given up a long time back, especially in the case like Bangalore. The government said they can treat the waste if the city has got a population of 3 to 4 million, and now we are at 12 or 13 million. So they given up. So they said, guys, so polluter pays. So the societies or residents should pay, should put STP, and they have to maintain it. So the onus is now to the end users to make it. So the, for them, the only choice to put a motor-based STP, which is very expensive. So compared to motor-based STP, we are much cheaper. As I said, the return of investment is less than 2 years. So if you can plug it in, less than 2 years is the ROI. It's a very sustainable model. Yeah, so the, so eventually what happening now is, the since the government has given up, everybody puts an STP, nice STP, motor-based STP, and they switch off and let out of the drain. So they're switching off because they can't afford to run the power and or run operators or chemicals. So we tell him, we are telling the residents, don't switch off, run it. It's a very natural solution. So that's a play. That's what we're trying to do it. Deepak.
Okay, that's good. So the other question is, what is the quality of effluent discharge with conventional aerobic septic tank? I mean, is it better? Is it comparable? Or are there other BOD, COD characteristics which you would like to qualify?
Right, right. So we that's a premise, the basic to be in the game. You need to conform to the norms. So we conform to all the latest NGT norms, that's BOD-10. We can even do better, but that's not a requirement. In fact, one of our clients, we're giving drinking quality water from the STP. They're not started drinking yet. They want use of bathing. So you can achieve any level of quantity. Of course, it'll cost money, bigger area space. But certainly we meet all the PCB norms. So we can do it better, but we're only doing up to the what the pollution control board norms require. But we can always
Thank
do
you.
Better.
You know, I've heard of this venture in California, which is called Toilet to Tap. I mean, you seem to be heading in the same direction as a benchmark.
Yes, yes.
That's good.
We're doing,
nice.
We're doing that. We're doing that.
Okay. Can I ask Hasit the question? Hasit, if you can hear me.
Yes.
Okay, so eco-friendly materials and construction technology. I mean, what are the challenges you faced in your journey to, you know, connect these dots of getting agri waste or other such materials to fuse them together, to convert them into finished products and use them?
Yeah, I think, well, what we realized is, I think broadly any new materials development, has a lot of challenges, primarily because of the kind of properties we want, you know, especially if you're making a structural element out of it, you know, the mechanical properties, you know, that requirement is enormous. And then also the, you know, the environmental factors need to be accounted for. And then there's this aging, right? Like we want to promise that this would last for 20 years, but then how do we know it will last for 20 years when it has never been used for 20 years? So there are all these accelerated tests that we have to do. And if you're any binders, additives, chemicals, anything that we use, how they will all interact with each other. So all that has to be studied very, very carefully. I think when we started, you know, in all honesty, we never thought of, developing materials. We just thought that, you know, we'll use off-the-shelf materials and make a modular roof that's just strong with certain defined, you know, characteristics. Waterproof, you know, a beautiful looking insulating, and you know, it'll be all be done in 6 months and we'll start raising money and so on. We took 2.5 years. You know, we realized that the current materials were not sufficient. Either they'll have termites issue or corrosion issue, or they would not last, you know, long enough. So that's when we started to develop our own materials, and we realized, you know, why not give waste a try. You know, so we started to use waste cardboard, coconut fibers. We'd use all sorts of binders. You know, we never realized that binders would be that much of a challenge. How everything would work together, as I said, you know, compatibility, and then testing all of that, you know, that it would actually last 20 years. We are doing a critical product like roofing. You know, we don't want it to fall on somebody or somebody to fall through the roof. And so we had to ensure all of that. So ensuring mechanical properties and ensuring, you know, environmental resistance, doing those long-term tests in a very, very accelerated manner, understanding the molecular sort of, you know, dynamics of it was just all very challenging. It continues to be a challenge because the newer additives, newer things we add, they're not as available, and how do they interact, and the expertise has to be developed, and you know, it becomes a global search for materials and experts. So it's fun, but it's very challenging.
Yeah, thanks. It reminds me of a saying which says, you know, you must live in a house where friends don't fall out and roofs don't fall in. So I think you qualify that statement. Absolutely. Yeah, so thank you so much. My next question is to Aditya Jain. Hi, Aditya. Okay, the world is dominated with cement and concrete. Now, you're also doing something which is based in concrete. How do you think your product is going to either reduce or, you know, comparably, you know, change the extraction of natural resources fundamentally? How different is 3D from concrete?
Right. So concrete and cement contributes considerably to the global climate challenge that we have, and it is something that contributes to the carbon footprint of the world. So we have been trying to reduce the amount of cement that we use, and also in the long run trying to move away from cement as a material altogether. So this is something that we have been trying, but the fact of the matter is India is a country which is dominated by concrete-based construction technologies. And concrete is not only dominating the current, construction which is carrying out, it is also dominating people's aspirations. So people want a pucca house, people want there have been issues with houses which are not made of solid materials because people don't find it acceptable enough. So for the current market, we do have to work with it. But what we are trying to do is incorporate as much recycled materials into our current material as possible. That is materials such as fly ash, silica fume, which are already, lying as waste in, let's say, a coal power plant or electronics manufactured power plant. So that has been our current effort as of now. We have tried with alternative materials such as soil, but materials such as soil vary in properties from place to place and it becomes difficult to standardize. In the long run, we want to move towards one, low carbon cement, which we are already working on, and also completely avoid cement by using materials such as geopolymers, which can have much higher recycled material content. And another project that we are currently doing with CSIR, CBRI as an organization that Shailesh mentioned is to incorporate construction and demolition waste into our concrete itself. That is a challenge because it has to be powdered down into a very fine form, and that powdering process itself is sometimes expensive, sometimes carbon, it contributes to carbon emissions as well. So coming up with that process and making sure that material goes well with our concrete has been a challenge. We are working on that, but it will be a long-term effort to reduce concrete-based cement use without compromising on the aspirations of people or the quality of the structure.
Yeah, thank you, Adit. In fact, the last piece was interesting to us also because we've just floated a global challenge on C&D waste, that is construction and demolition waste.
Okay.
It is to seek innovative solutions from solvers around the world to give us methodologies, processes, innovative ideas on how to estimate the kind of C&D waste, how to characterize it, how to give us good transportation models and end technology of recycling. So it may be of to you and your colleagues or your the academic staff at the IIT Chennai to look at this challenge because it's a very valid concern with these ad hoc landfills coming up and you know water bodies getting filled up. So thanks again. Absolutely. And I now take the next question to Sorek Aditya.
Yeah,
Aditya, if you can hear me. Yeah, okay. Yes. So very interesting stuff you told us. So acceptability of such products, of course, is a challenge for you. And apart from that, getting regulatory approvals on your design and on your product, I think you're well versed with that. How do you scale up across geographies? I mean, working out of, say, one small state of Gujarat is fine, but you know, you're linking up waste, landfills, urban local bodies, your own factory manufacturing processes, and a market. So what's your scale-up plan like?
So basically what happens, like if you see what we are doing is, a technology has a use case. So what we have developed is converting waste into products, a building material, then it can be converted into multiple products, such as paver block, brick, tiles, interlocking structures, or elevating wall, claddings, like things, replacing precast concrete as such in applications. But what happens is like all these things are very, very local and indigenously regulated. For example, each state of India has their own schedule of rates, their own use case of different things. In India, western side, you will find use of lime more than on the eastern side, you will find the use of fly ash or other systems more. It depends on the availability of the material. And therefore, what we've done is we have customized the technology in such a way that we will give you a tech part where you can have your own indigenous source waste. For example, you have availability of sand, or you have availability of fly ash, or you have availability of construction and demolition waste, recycled aggregate, or any kind of dolomite or marble slurry, different kinds of waste. So you can utilize that as an individual filler or aggregate part. And then the universality of plastic waste is everywhere. For example, in the cities to urban areas, the plastic waste is available. And that too, we focus on such plastic which are not being recycled as of right now. So for example, if you see packaging plastics, like from Kurkure wafer packets to plastic wafer packets or different kinds of packaging material. So these are not being recycled heavily because they uses their lifetime value just after the first use. So single use plastic loses its 95% of its value just after the first use. There is no recycling process or end product which can be made out of it. So that's our goal. So utilize the kind of waste which is being dumped right now. Utilize the kind of resources which have no afterlife use available locally and convert them into products. Now, so they're providing a system which can convert them into a material. And then there is a molding process. So molding process is just a forming process. If you consider, say, you want to make a tile, you can make a tile. If you want to make a block, you can make a block. If you want to make a roof tile, you can make a roof tile. So that's a molding process. So molding process can be customized as per the customer's demand or the area of the market. For example, on the Konkan route, I think the roof shingles will work very brilliantly. But on the western part in Gujarat, the paving and roads work very brilliant. So that's the availability of the demand of the product. So therefore, the scale-up model is in a simple form. We are providing a technology system which you can employ. We can customize it as per your need for the location and the market of the product. And then you can start sourcing the material locally and convert them into product, which can be sold locally into the market.
Thanks. Okay, I just wanted to have a word from you on your observations on the mentoring support you got from the construction chemicals industry, which was facilitated by Habitat. Do you think that was a good initiative, and it's something which should be continuing further? And how did it help you as Saltech?
So basically what happens is like when you develop a material, the biggest challenge is how you can certify its scope and get it into market with the comparable material already present. And that's where when we got connected with Dow Chemicals by Habitat. So the biggest advantage which we got was already what is being used heavily into the market, into construction chemical or the different tackling processes, and how we can optimize our process to be cost efficient and comparable to them in terms of property, or get our properties better. So that was the first thing in technical term. The second was the mentorship was for my, it was not only on the technical side. They also provided me on the business side also. So they got me connections with good people who are working into recycling segment. And we are working with them to do a project, pilot project, in which we can showcase and demonstrate the technology on the global level to different people who are already coming up to hands and work on the recycling of the plastics and convert them some to products. So that's a win-win for both the sides. So somebody who is a polluter can do a EPR and convert their waste into a product. And somebody who is in need can utilize this product as a subsidized cost or less than market cost. So that's a win-win for the both sides.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. And for the sake of time, I'll give just one question for KBSS and keep it as short as possible. Tejinder, if you could just tell us,
sure.
zero carbon homes and climate change. I mean, briefly, how do you contextualize both these?
Sure. So I would like to start with your words, where world is largely dominated by cement and concrete-based construction technology. So LSSB, lime stabilized soil technology, is one of initiative by Koshalbao on environment-friendly construction part. So when I say about zero carbon home is a technology based on lime and lime stabilized soil block, which is not only environment friendly, but which is also locally accessible, locally available. So zero carbon home is an ecosystem which ensure quality of life through solar panel, right? Which ensure wholesome food through nutrition garden and cooking gas
Okay, so you got an integrated home with solar panels, you got a designed home with illumination, you got a thermally comfortable home because of good cladding, etc. Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Thanks. Thank you, Tejinder. That was nice. And as a wrap up now, I would like to thank firstly Sankalp and all the lineup of panelists for, you know, such a illuminating and illustrative talk on what they've been doing. Technologies, new technologies are at the forefront. We've got to be pushing these into all sectors, including construction, which has generally been lethargic and a little high on inertia, to change. Things are changing, and I would like to wish our panelists all the best, and thanks Sankalp once again for this opportunity. Over to you, Meera.
Thank you. Thank you, Deepak. And thank you all the panelists. I particularly, want to thank Tejinder. They are doing a, wonderful project in Orissa. And we will be sharing more details once the house is constructed. And, the idea is to get the product out and get it certified to be green and everything. So with this, we will wrap the session with this last note that we are doing one more session, actually two more, on November 6th, one session in the afternoon and one in the evening. Please do join us, and any questions, any further information, you can always write to us. We have put in our contact information there. And thank you, Sankalp, for all the support through this, and have a good evening, everybody.